Parasite. Okay, so if you have not watched the movie and are here, please reconsider as I will be spoiling a lot of things about this movie. Click here to see my spoiler-free review of the movie first, and if you still feel like this movie has nothing to do with you and you don't mind ruining the experience, then sure, stick around. Before we begin, do you remember that bell sound that plays in the very first scene of the movie as the production company logo appears? That's to test if theater speakers are functioning properly in all angles. Yeah, that's the kind of director we're dealing with here. So imagine the plethora of symbolic details that'll be hidden throughout to help augment the main theme of the movie. Isn't it exciting? Now, you should only be here if you have watched the movie, so I'll be assuming you know the plot already for the sake of time. We're all precious and got things to do. These are just my personal findings, ideas, and are not necessarily correct or the only available interpretation. Here's your very last warning, and start. The very first thing I noticed, even before we get to the reveals and the main conflicts, was the contrast between up and down, or high and low, used for class representation of each character in a capitalist world. The movie opens up with the camera petting down from up to Kiyu. Soon after, we learn that Park's mansion is located at what seems like the highest point in town, whereas Gitek's place is not only lower but a semi-basement, with the toilet being the highest point of the house. Eventually, when we get introduced to Gunsa's family, we see that they live in a full basement with no natural light. Another thought-provoking detail is how the upper-class Park family never looks down. When Giyu is hidden under Daya's bed, she doesn't look under despite the puppy, whose name is pretty much the same as mine, constantly peeks inside and makes noise. Same thing happens for Gitek's other family members hidden under the table in the living room. Park and his wife Youngyu never notice. Finally, despite the lower storage area clearly having a mobile shelf due to the rail mark on the floor, and really, if it was me who moved in, I would have found out in a day, they never find out what is under. It's conceivable that their behavior depicted as such are actually more realistic, or maybe I'm interpreting a purely cinematic choice as bearing a meaning, but I thought it's interesting enough. I will get back to this idea, but capitalism, beyond any doubt, is a recurring theme in this movie, planted to better discuss what Parasite truly means, and this contrast between up and down is one splendid means to present it. Just to briefly add to this notion of contrast being used for depiction of family differences and the theme of capitalism, other polar opposites are shown back to back or simultaneously for further reinforcement. For example, in the scene where Chung-suk makes ramen noodles for the returning Parks, you can see that she also adds cube steak inside. For those of you who are not familiar with Korean culture, the two noodles she mixes and cooks are a Western equivalent of a fucking McGangbang, and by no means an elegant recipe. On the other hand, local beef is considered one of the most expensive cuts of meat you can have in Korea. The fact that she mixed the two to me was an in-your-face way of clarifying that the noodles are the Kim family and the beef, Park family. The two are not meant to be mixed, and the fact that they are seems ridiculous. Youngyu really enjoys the noodles and seems oblivious to the fact that the recipe in front of her is laughable at best, exactly like how she is oblivious to the true identity of the Kim family. Similarly, the heavy rain sequence sketches compelling polar images, bringing tragic loss for one area and a blessing of a clear sky and air to another. The scene where Gitek is driving Youngyu back home after grocery shopping is the perfect moment of clash between the two opposites, as she thanks the rain for the lack of dust particles. You can see Gitek just worn down because of that thankful rain, and visibly annoyed by the statement. Likewise, it's amusing how the fancy toy tent was fine under the rain, but the lower class houses were not in that neighborhood. Lastly, as a sprinkle on top, the genre itself starts off as mostly heist comedy and switches to thriller slash drama for the second half of the film. Water and stone are two other symbols that reappear throughout the movie. In short, I believe water symbolizes anything in line with reality, destiny, inevitability, or the place to be, and the stone, false hope, delusion, or fakery. the park's mansion, equipped with loads of clean, expensive bottles of water, displays their financial power comparable to Gitek's family, where the only liquid they seemed to receive was a drunk guy's urine. Eventually, in the raining scene, Gitek's family members are carried back down to their true dwelling by water. This scene is significant on many levels, since it also tells the audience that the rich-poor gap cannot realistically be closed simply by trying hard. Like water flowing downwards but not up, it's in truth very unnatural for the poor to go up a rank in a capitalism-centered society. This is partly why it seems so tiring and far to go back down to Gitek's neighborhood, but always omitted their journey up to the park's mansion. Simply put, the up journey was never really true. It was falsely given to them, and the gap seems small and feasible that way. When water breaks the delusion, the gap becomes evident on their way home and seems impossible to close. Giyu, the direct link, and arguably the cause of all happening, stares down at his own feet, pushed downward by the water, in disbelief as he comes to terms with reality for a split second. His inner collision is understandable as he was more exposed to this false hope than the rest of his family, acting as the link between the upper and lower through his interaction with Min, his friend. After their gateway to upper class opened up, borrowing his own words, he was all about vigor, desire and ambition rather than actuality. Therefore, even here he asks, what would Min do in this situation, characterizing his desire and his state of denial? To which Gijeong answers, Min wouldn't be in this situation. Wake the hell up. And that's why, when Gitek's family finally reaches home, Giyu only takes the stone back with him. This is a stone given by Min. This is the stone that allowed him to be like Min, to imitate the rich, to feel like the rich. With that stone is how Giyu is able to stay in denial with comfort. Note that when he goes back home, stone seems to magically float and appear in front of Giyu. And he even mentions that the stone keeps clinging to him. Giyu was always the ambitious one in the family. And for him, who always talked about things being symbolic and metaphorical, the stone becomes his symbol of desire. The stone isn't an accessory. It's a necessity. He tries to fight the drunk man off with the stone. He gets in a relationship with Dahae just like Min did. He decides to put an end to this mess by killing Geunsae with what? The stone. It's just a sad irony that he nearly gets killed by the stone at the end, as if the pushed reality has piled up enough to finally push back. I hinted this idea slightly in explaining the previous symbol, but the characters' fates are clear from the get-go. In the first scene where the pest control company undergoes fumigation process for Gitek's neighborhood, Gijeong, the daughter, is the first one to react and attempt to close the window. Gitek, however, tells her not to and lets the smoke come in for free extermination. Everyone coughs except Gitek. Coincidence? I think not. Do you remember how Chung-soo compares Gitek to a cockroach before the Park family just storms in? Moments later, the entire family is scattered and hidden around the house like a roach. As they slowly move away from the table, Park is woken up by Dasung's flashlight and Gitek freezes in the spot until the flashlight is off again. Which seriously looked like something a cockroach would do. As a cherry on top, all of Gitek's family members have either Gi or Chung in their name. Considering the Korean word for parasite is Giseng-chung, the point is pretty clear. So if they really are like cockroaches, what would be their end result? Giyu tells Gijeong that she fits in the best with the Parks, but ironically is the only one to die. Just like how she was the first to try to close the window, she is the least parasitic, if you will. Giyu's character is foreshadowed by the stone discussed before, and Gitek is the only one to continue the life underground, realizing that's where he belongs. And he takes it like a roach, like he took the smoke. On the side, I must point out how the Native American theme foreshadowed Park family's failure in getting rid of Gitek's family invading their space. I thought it was pretty clever. What's unusual about this movie is that the rich are not sketched as villains and poor not as victims. The line between good and bad is so ambiguous that you just do not know which character to side with. They all have their own flaws. Just when we think a character is good or bad, he or she will turn the wheel. In the end, all the characters seem the same deep inside. It's the harsh reality that separated them all to have one aspect emphasized more than the other. What reality? Well, Architects' family members all have incredible skill sets, but that does not equal jobs, does it? But if Park views Gitek's family as classy, they will sound classy. Does that change the fact that they are flawed human beings? No. Does that make Park perfect? Not that either. Don't you remember how he talks against his previous ideas when he gets down with his wife? That's the point. It's only the rank that gave one more opportunity than the other. They're all the same. The only difference that comes with rank difference is smell. Same smell on them. Gitek's family is described to have a smell similar to the one that can be found in subways and metros. Okay, that's an attack on all classes except the upper. Ki-jung yells out how it's the semi-basement smell, one that cannot be washed away and can only be exterminated by living a completely different lifestyle. Well, or simply put, become richer. You see, when Park plugs his nose in front of dead Geun-se, Gitek snaps not solely because he hated the way Park talked about his smell, but more so because he can't stand the fact that Park treats Geun-se just like he treats Gitek. Aha, Gitek considered Geun-se to be inferior to his family, which makes sense because Geun-se's family lives in the basement, not semi-basement. If you remember, Gitek's family used to be somewhere. Gitek has tried different startups, Chung-suk has won a medal for shot put, Gyo could afford to apply for university 4 freaking times. They're clearly better off than Geun-se's family, who doesn't even have any children. Gitek even patronizes Geun-se by saying, "Don't you have a plan? What are you going to do?" When funny enough, he always took no plan as best plan and praised his son for even having a plan because, well, he didn't have a plan. This is related to the previously discussed up and down aspect as well, and critically why this movie is different. Gitek's family does not side with Geun-se's family. Not only is the villain-victim line blurry, but the confrontational structure is as well. It's not a simple fight between the rich and the poor. If there is poor, there is poorer. And for the poor is a roach, not a team. I hope my message is getting across by this point. Who is the parasite? If I had to choose, it'd be Geun-se in the beginning and Gitek by the end. But truthfully, seeing how it reminded me of the 1944 existentialist French play, Wicklow, I must say that it's everyone and not just one particular character who becomes a parasite in this capitalism-centered setting, feeding off of each other to their own demise. Dongik Park, Geun-se, Moon-gang, and Ki-jung dead. Yeon-gyo, Tae, and the already traumatized enough Ta-sung left scarred for life. Gitek in the basement, punishing himself and living the rest of his life, sending Morse code with no certainty. And Gyu finally letting go of the stone, only to replace it with his letter to his father. A tragic tale that ends in nothing but inevitability, to the very last frame. As Gyu stands up again with that letter in one hand and an ambitious plan on the other, the audience already knows he will fail. Nothing works out according to your plan because, really, no plan is the best plan. And as always, that's it for me.